Hey, everybody, and welcome back to another episode of the Speak Plainly podcast, where we speak plainly about things that matter. I am your host, Owl Medicine, and today I'm super excited because we're going to be talking about one of my favorite people in history ever. I absolutely love this guy. I love everything about his whole life and story, outside of the fact that he died a virgin, most likely. We're talking about Espiranza Baroch Spinoza, or later Benedict Spinoza. This guy is amazing for a lot of reasons. He, just to give you a little brief introduction, he has been called a God-obsessed man and is definitely, there's a lot of arguments between whether he's a pantheist or an atheist or a few other ists that I hadn't even heard of until I did more research preparing for this podcast. This guy is super duper awesome. Espiranza Baroch Spinoza was born in Amsterdam in 1632 on November 24th. He's kind of cuspy, but I actually looked up his birth chart because I'm me, and I'm very, very happy to say that we have really oddly similar birth charts. We have tons of stuff in Sagittarius. Our Mercury's in the same place. It's pretty cool. Anyway, I love this guy, so anything that compares me to him is also awesome. Oh, and let me tell you how I found Baroch Spinoza, because it's embarrassing and hilarious. I took a philosophy CLEP. I never actually took a philosophy class. I thought philosophy was interesting. I did a little bit of research on my own. And then in the military, you're able to take CLEPs, which is basically you take the final of a class. And if you pass the final without taking the class, then you get credit for the class. So that's what I did on philosophy and never even bothered taking a class and passed because it was super easy. And the CLEP was cool because it really wasn't hard. All you had to do was match up old dead white people with what old dead white people liked to say. And that was fine because they were pretty straightforward. But I actually didn't learn about Baroch Spinoza doing research into philosophy or philosophers. I actually found Spinoza through a astrology meme about Sagittarians, and it was something about how to impress a Sagittarius or something, and it was like, just quote Spinoza, and I was like, what? Who is this guy? Who's Spinoza? And then I looked him up, and I fell in love. He's absolutely amazing. So let me just read you some quotes about this guy and his work, okay? So he wrote four books. He died before he was 50, and he wrote four books, almost all of which posthumously, and by his friends, and they were all banned in the Dutch Republic, which was by far at the time the most free country in the world, and that's part of why he was there. Harold Bloom says, as a teacher of reality, Spinoza practiced his own wisdom and was surely one of the most exemplary human beings to have ever lived. Another old philosopher, Guy Deleuze, called him the Prince of Philosophy. Gertrude Russell says, noblest and most lovable of the great philosophers, intellectually some others have surpassed him, but ethically he is supreme. And I love, this is my favorite one. Post Spinoza, you are either a Spinozist or no kind of philosopher at all. That's my favorite. Like, this dude, before he was 50, like, wrote these books that didn't even get published until after he was born, and he absolutely changed the face of the world forever, because the first book, the one that we're going to talk about the most, is called The Ethics. That's his Piste de Resistance. There's another name for it, but I forgot what it was. So Piste de Resistance, it will work. it explores ethics and how to essentially live a great life, live your best life, and how to do that ethically. Spinoza never got a degree. He never had a degree, but he was actually offered a teaching position at the University of Heidelberg, and he actually turned down that teaching position because he, in order to work there, had to make a promise that he would be less of a heretic, essentially. Okay, so I've been beating around the bush for a minute. Let's get to why is this man a heretic? Along with those other great quotes about him, let me read you some other cool quotes. So the ethics, it was a splash, baby. This book made a splash. It was banned in Holland, which was the freest country in the world at the time. It was banned in the Dutch Republic as a, quote, profane, atheistic, and blasphemous book. The political treatise that he wrote was named the most dangerous book ever published. It was called A Book Forged in Hell. And also, interestingly enough, Spinoza is also described as a God-intoxicated man and as a heretic and an atheist. So how can somebody be a heretic and an atheist, be a God-obsessed man and an atheist? Also, how can he be an atheist and a pantheist and a determinist and all these other ists? Well, first off, the ists don't matter because they're just an easy way to categorize things. And his philosophy is so gorgeous. It's so gorgeous. I love it so, so much, because if you actually compare his philosophy, there's a bunch of it that matches beautifully with the Kabbala and Jewish mysticism, which is gorgeous because his family were Jewish, his mother and father, and they were actually run out of their country of origin for their faith, and then had to hide their faith for a long time. It's actually also said that one of his parents was like an active, like, underground church leader kind of thing, back when you could get killed for that. Not even back when, you can still get killed for that in certain places. But I digress. So what exactly is this book, The Ethics? Because that's the big one. That's the big one he wrote. So what is this book? What does it do? What's the point? And why in the world did it piss off so many people? Well, it has five chapters, all right? So it's five books in it. It's like five chapters, books, treatises, whatever you want to call them. And the first one is on God. The second chapter is on nature and the mind. It's epistemology, how you know things, how a person can know stuff. The third and fourth chapters are on nature and function of psychology. It really just kind of explores human psychology, the foundations and the functions of it. And the final chapter is all about the potential to escape suffering using the intellect. The potential to escape suffering. That sounds really familiar. Who does that sound like? Oh, Siddhartha. That's who that sounds like. It sounds like the Buddha. This dude was like the 16th century intellectualist's Buddha, which is exactly why you might be starting to get the picture of why people hated him. So that last chapter, let's harp on that for a minute, because this last chapter is gorgeous. The last chapter is all about the good life. How do you live the good life, the sweet life, the golden life? All over the world, you go to Italy, and it's like the Viva Leche or whatever. That's not the right word. I just combined two different languages. Whatever. But everywhere you go, they have translations in their languages for the sweet life, the good life, the beautiful life, because that's all anybody's really trying to live. And the places that we Americans go in order to vacation, we go to the places where people just want to have a nice life. I don't know why we only vacation to places where people want to enjoy life instead of living in a way that allows us to enjoy life, but I digress again. Spinoza wanted to. He wanted to live a beautiful life, a beautiful ethical life. And that's what this whole book was about. And nobody can be so hated without doing something pretty profound. And what he did with the ethics was... The ethics is that's what it's called now, but it's actually the ethics something something geometric stuff. And the reason it's the geometric stuff is because that first chapter on God, here's where things get wonky. So he has to define God, because the whole first chapter is defining terms. And that's it. That's like, this whole thing is logical, right? He's a logical philosopher. He's trying to figure out how to live an ethical life rationally. How can we think through things to come to a philosophy that allows us to live a beautiful life? And that begins with at least defining terms. So that's what the entire first chapter is. It's defining terms of what is God? Well, according to Spinoza, God is substance. All substance, both energy and mass. That's what God is. Because God has to be all-inclusive. There is nothing outside of God. In fact, the founder of Hasidic Judaism wrote, "All is God, and God is all." And Deuteronomy 4:35 says, "No God, none beside him," in the King James Version. So for Spinoza, substance is God. All things that exist are God. And that's kind of a radical concept. But he really breaks this down purely logically. So don't get too weirded out yet. So the step number one is that substance is God. And then step number two, after you get substances, when you're looking through Spinoza's stuff, you have to think in this acronym, SAM, which is Substance, Attributes, and Modes. Substance is God itself. So when you read even the Bible or something, in Spinoza's world and in my world, anytime you read the word God, or anytime that you read the word nature, you're reading the same thing. And that actually is his most famous line from his book, is God or nature, except in Latin, because Latin. God or nature. And I love that juxtaposition, because it feels like it's making you choose. It's like, well, God or nature. That feels like a choice. But also, because they're just sitting right next to each other, you either have to kind of bring down God to nature's level, or elevate nature to God's level. If they're the same, if there is legitimately a choice between the two, and that choice matters for any reason, then they must be comparable. And I think that this is part of his genius, is pointing out where things are comparable when they didn't used to be. They weren't comparable according to the culture of the time. But I think that's beautiful. Is it God or is it nature? And for him, that was two words meaning the exact same thing. Because God, by definition, is substance. And the reason he pissed off so many people is because the very beginning of this book, he lays out these terms like, all right, these are the attributes of God. And if these are the attributes of God, there's only one logical solution. The attributes of God make God substance. And that's the reason he pissed everybody off, is because he was right. And nothing will piss off the world more than being right when they don't want you to be right. So he set up these terms in the very, very beginning of the book, and then walks you through perfect, logical, rational reasoning from a thing that you agree with to a thing that you disagree with, which is that God and nature are the same thing, and that there is no personal God. There is no transpersonal God. That we are, well, a worm in the blood. I jumped ahead a little bit, but that's fine. The worm in the blood story is a really great story because, like, Plato has the allegory of the cave, right? Well, and his is about, like, being a philosopher, being tied up in a cave, and there's shadows dancing, and you think the shadow's real, and you leave, and you see that they're not, and you come back and try to tell people, and they tell you that you're crazy. That's a little bit of what happened to Spinoza here. But I like Spinoza's famous allegory better because it's universally applicable, not just applicable to philosophers. In Spinoza's, we're a worm, and we're in the blood. So imagine you're a little worm, worming along, wiggle, wiggle, wiggle worm, and you're seeing blood stuff. You're seeing blood, red blood cells and white blood cells. It's the plasma all around. There's all kinds of little things inside the blood, all kinds of living little stuff. And everything's doing things. And you don't really know what they're doing. You just see them doing stuff. You see the red blood cells carrying oxygen. You see them shaped a specific way. And you see these different things behaving in different ways. You see specific things behaving in specific ways. And you don't really have any ideas to why. So you think naturally that they are an autonomous entity in the same way that you are an autonomous entity and complete within themselves. Not realizing that you are actually inside a body, like a human body or a little kitty cat body or whatever body. I'm assuming he meant human because it was the worm in the blood and he probably was talking about that, but it really doesn't matter. Being inside a body as a worm, watching all these little things, you automatically project your own reality onto them, that you experience yourself as an autonomous individual, so you expect other independent things, things not of you, to also be autonomous little individuals. And that is exactly the way that we, as people, experience life. I see you, you see me, I think you're an entity, you think I'm an entity, but in reality, we are all a part of one giant universe, and smaller than that, we're a part of one city, or one room, or one county, or one state, or one country. Perspective is everything. So whatever perspective you're looking at it from makes the biggest difference. So the story of the worm in the blood is really meant to point out that we are a part of something larger than us. And if we use that rationality, that can lead us down a beautiful, beautiful path. The path to the good life, as he calls it. And for him, what is the path to the good life? How do you actually get there? And he believes that you can use logic and rationale and reasoning. And basically, the logic, rationale, and reasoning that he has is God is not a creator God. He didn't one day of his own free will decide to create the universe. That God, in its existence, that is to say the universe itself, nature, all the energy, and all of the matter in the universe, that is God. And because it exists, it necessarily creates. Now, I know that sounds weird, but because it exists, it necessarily creates. In the same way that three acute angles will come together to make a triangle. Three acute angles, when they come together, no matter what, when you put them end to end, will create a triangle. That is because of the nature of the right angles and the nature of a triangle. And the nature of our concepts of right angles and triangles, right? But that is the nature of right angles, acute angles and triangles. If you put three acute angles together, you're going to get a triangle. In the same way, if you have a God, you will have creation. So this also, for me, beautifully fits into the Tao, because that means from one there was two, from two there was the many. And I find that beautiful. I find this really awesome. So if we have now God, so now we have settled God is substance, universe, energy, matter, nature, all the things. God is all the things, which means now we have the S down. We have to go to the A. We have to go to the attributes. What are the attributes of God? See, and that's fun for me. I love this stuff because I grew up in such a ridiculously religious family. I love this kind of thing. So the attributes are the primary expressions of substance. It is the observable phenomenon. Matter and energy are the same thing. Like I said, that is substance. And Spinoza rejected the Aristotelian idea of form and matter. And he replaced form and matter from Aristotle with his own version of thought and extension. And thought and extension is how we as human beings understand the attributes of God. That is how we dissect the attributes of God. That's how we kind of carve up our own reality, and our reality is created of substance or God. Again, making every single thing around you a piece of God. So the thought is the concept, and then the extension is the physical thing. All right, I know this feels a little backwards, but it works well with its own interior logic for this. So the thought is the concept, and the extension is the physical thing. Love, the extension of that, is the physiological explanation. That's the explanation of cortisol rising to get you a little bit stressed, but also all the dopamine coming up to make you feel good, and all the oxytocin, and that whole biological cascade of events that creates this feeling that we call love. That is the extension. The thought of love are the stories of love. They're the Hollywood movies. They're poetry. They're music and art about love. That's the thought. Right. So that's how we break up substance. Is the substance goes into its attributes and to its modes. So let's look at modes next. Modes are also called the affections by Spinoza, which I just think is freaking adorable. And in here, again, he breaks it down to infinite modes and finite modes. And by the way, I really love this because he's just breaking these down and then breaking each one of them down into two. And it feels very Chinese medicine to me. And it feels very yin and yang. It feels very energy and substance. And it's beautiful. So in the modes, he has infinite modes, which are permanent extensions, which is like a chair, versus the finite modes, which is a concept of a chair. So, and I didn't like this at first, but I like it now because as we talk about infinite and finite modes, later on, something I learned toward the end really tied that together. But, so what does this all mean? Like, what in the world does that mean? Basically, it means that in Spinoza's philosophy, God and nature are the same thing. That God is not an entity with free will and interferes with the lives of man. Spinoza's God is also Einstein's God. I meant to start this podcast with the Einstein quote. When Einstein was asked if he believed in God, he said he believes in Spinoza's God. And if that ain't enough to catch your attention, then I don't know what is gonna be, because it's so good. It's so good. God is literally all the things in the universe, all the matter. And then God's attributes are basically the kind of functions or the physics of the world. And I don't just mean the physics of matter, but the physics of emotion and the physics of energy. There are other forms of physics, even thermal physics and stuff like that, we know the names of, but these other forms are the attributes. And then the modes makes you a mode. That makes me a mode. We're all modes of God. We are the finite modes of God. We are limited. But what does this mean? So there's some implications to this, and I hope that you're following. If not, then you're along with everybody else, because I feel like anybody who's interested in philosophy understands that you'll get a little piece of what they meant, and the rest of it you probably won't, and it really doesn't matter. We're just going to all pretend that it made us better and move on with our lives. But the real, like, where the rubber hits the road for me in this is, if God is everything, then it kind of gives birth to this concept that I was new to called necessitarianism, which basically just means that everything is exactly the way that it is meant to be. And not meant to be in a, like, oh, it's meant to be, that's going to be really nice. But no, in the way that it has to be. Everything is exactly the way that it has to be. It is necessary that things are the way that they are. And the reason that it's necessary that things are exactly the way that they are is because causality is very real. And causality, stemming from this original chapter one term setting of terms and definitions, and then moving through this logical process, you're eventually forced to come to terms with that kind of destroys any chance of free will, really. Because if God is all things and all of those things act the way that they do through their attributes, manifesting as modes, both finite as you and me and infinite as our concepts of you and me, that if all things are necessary because of causality, something caused the decision to be made that affected you. Something caused the light to turn red at the wrong time. Something caused the driver to go through that red light. Something caused all of these things. But it's not just one thing. In reality, logically, it was an infinite chain of causality that created the event that you were dealing with that you like or don't like. It was an infinite chain of causality that you had no control over. And so by accepting this necessitarianism, essentially, you're accepting that the things that are happening around you, whether you like them or not, are a natural expression, and you can just accept that. And that's really useful, because that is the key to eliminating suffering. And Buddhism, the way I describe suffering is like stubbing your toe causes you pain. telling everyone that you meet that day that you stubbed your toe that morning and re-experiencing the sadness of it, that's suffering. Not only are you suffering because you're constantly recollecting that pain and telling that story over and over again, but chances are the people that you're talking to don't really care about it, and you're causing some suffering on their behalf because they don't have good boundaries to tell you to shut up. But that's the difference between pain and suffering. And you can't avoid pain. Life is pain. Get over it. But you can avoid suffering. You can avoid suffering. And I love this because this was not the Buddha. This was not attained through meditation or nirvana, like this nirvana-like state. He has his own nirvana and his way of getting there. He says the greatest love, the greatest form of joy in the world, the only real and lasting form of joy in the world, is to mentally fall in love with something that is infinite. I'm going to say that again. He says, the greatest joy in the world is to fall in love intellectually with something infinite. If you could do that, you will have an endless supply of joy. He says the intellectual love of God is his joy. It is finding this intellectual love of God. And according to his definition of God, that makes him love everything and everyone. Which is why, even though he wrote these books that were books forged in hell and the most dangerous book ever published, but the last chapter was all about how to be a good person, how to manifest a good life for yourself and everyone around you using basic rational thinking. Maybe not basic, but using rational, logical thought, how you can eliminate suffering in your own life. And I think that's freaking magical. I think it's wonderful. I love Spinoza because he blended mysticism and philosophy. He blended spirituality and intellectualism in a masterful way that he apparently lived. He died at 44 years old because after he was excommunicated from the Jewish church, which, by the way, I think when I did this research, there's only been two people ever. Like, Catholics excommunicate folks all the time. They're like, no, get out of here. Bye. Judaism doesn't really do that. The Jews are like, okay, whatever, bro. But not with Spinoza. And what's funny is he was actually excommunicated from Judaism at 23 years old. He hadn't even published anything yet. Like, he hadn't published anything yet. And he was excommunicated from Judaism. Like, that's crazy. For telling people to be nice to each other. But the way he did it was purely rational. And it forced the entire world to stare their own cognitive dissonances in the face. And nothing will piss people off faster. Nothing will piss people off faster than pointing out their cognitive dissonances in an undeniable way. And that's why everybody hated him. Well, that's why philosophers and the church at the time hated him. It was the church and the governments that really hated him. In Holland at the time, you could publish anything. Holland was by far the freest republic in the world. People from anywhere could come there and publish whatever they wanted. And even in Holland, he was banned. And it's all because he started off defining terms and then walked you through rationally, if this, then this, if this, then this, all the way to God is everything. And if God is everything and it expresses itself in these infinite numbers of ways, then we should treat everything as a tiny piece of God acting out its own attributes and modes. That's it. That's it. That's the end. Like, that was all he really wanted to do. And he did it in a beautiful way, where apparently everybody that knew him loved him as far as the way he treated people and the kindness that he had. And the reason he died at 44 is when he was excommunicated, he got a job as a lens grinder. He wound up inhaling so much glass that he wound up dying of tuberculosis at 44 years old, which is really sad. I wonder what he could have come up with after that, but it really seemed like his life's purpose was to do this, was to write the ethics and to build out this philosophy. And I love it with all of my heart, because I said for years that I believed that the universe only knows one thing, and that one thing is balance, and that the universe's perspective was so big and so wide that we can't possibly understand what that balance looks like. And so if we just trust that there is balance somewhere in there, that was my whole philosophy. And over the years, I've developed that more. And once I found Spinoza's, I was like, OMG, this is exactly everything that I believe, plus a million other things that I hadn't really put together yet in easily describable ways, at least. I love Spinoza. I love Spinoza's philosophy. I think he is absolutely marvelous. And I hope that you think Spinoza is awesome. There's a lot of really good YouTube stuff out there. Just look it up. There's so many cool, you can look up YouTube videos for different people who have done interviews, who are specialists on Spinoza. And Spinoza is so famous and was for so long that people that love Spinoza are called Spinozists. And that actually, for about 80 years, it was just under 100 years, for a little while after Spinoza died, people who were atheists were called Spinozists. Just all atheists were called Spinozists because he pissed off people that much. And that just, it makes my little rebel heart so happy. I love it. I love it. I love it. I love it. So, yeah, that's Spinoza. There's still more that I didn't cover. He talks about nature, and he breaks that into two categories, to natura naturans and natura naturata, which is the kind of the modes of God again, but breaks that down. I hope that this was really entertaining, and I hope that you have your interest piqued for Spinoza. Give it a Google. It's really you'll love him. You'll love what he does. He's, to me, the greatest philosopher ever, probably one of the greatest people ever. I wish I could read Latin. For a half a second, I considered learning to read Latin just so I could try to read the ethics. And I was like, no, I'm not that legit. That's why I'm not a scholar. that's literally for me, the definition of a scholar is you can be an expert in something, but you're not a scholar until you are an expert in that thing and in the context in which it existed. So if you're going to read Spinoza and consider yourself a scholar, you need to be an expert on 17th century Holland and what was happening with the religious cultures at the time, as well as speak Latin and Hebrew, because he wrote some stuff in Hebrew early on too. I can't do those things. I'm not interested in doing those things, but luckily there are people who are interested in doing those things, and I can help disseminate their information and wisdom out to you in my little owlish way. So I hope that I've done that, and I hope that you were thoroughly entertained and you have a fabulous day. All right, everybody. If you enjoyed this, consider contributing on Patreon. And remember, stay blessed and stay uncomfortable.
Thank you.